I've never even asked you this, but I'm going to pop it on you. I've always wondered that, remember this big furor that came out with the SSRIs causing suicide, and it was mostly in children and young adults. And this was in the era, actually, before the DSM-5, or very early in the DSM-5. I've always wondered, and this is what I do when I see children and adolescents, whether or not the increased suicidality was due to the fact that these kids were mixed and given SSRIs and they didn't know it.
Yeah.
And that just spooks the heck out of me. So if you're going to see children or adolescents, even if you're an adult psychiatrist, we encourage you to see adolescents because there's such need for treatment and not enough providers. Keep in mind to actually really drill for mixed features, because if you give somebody with mixed features an antidepressant, they'll get this treatment emergent and they may even get suicidality. Do you think that there's a possibility that if we'd gone back and done those studies and eliminated the mixed features, we wouldn't have a suicide warning on these drugs?
Yeah, I mean, looking at it from a retrospectoscope, who knows that if we had conceptualized these kids a bit differently. I mean, we're doing the same thing with trauma, too. Is everything that we saw back then, early childhood trauma and its impact, The problem with these issues that we haven't really resolved, particularly in kids, and I say this after now completing a randomized controlled trial where we gave offspring of parents with bipolar disorder escitalopram versus placebo, and kids actually in both arms improved. So there wasn't a clear-cut signal that these kids are highly sensitive. Some portion of them, guess what? About a third developed a treatment-emergent mania as a consequence of escitalopram compared to placebo. But the point I want to make is that the sensitivity and specificity is still working itself out in these dynamic organisms that are changing but are also at risk for side effects generally. Kids are just more predisposed to side effects. So we have to have that background information. That's why dosing is important. It's why we start low and go slow with kids. But the iterative evaluation of a child is just going to predispose you to doing a better job in the long run.
You know, that's the one thing that's different for me as an adult psychiatrist, a child psychiatrist, is that when you see an adult, I don't know if this is right or not, but you make a diagnosis, you kind of forget about it, and you just treat symptoms and, you know, of course, the illness. With a kid, you have to put your seatbelt on so you don't fall out of your chair. With each subsequent visit, you find out new things that you never saw before. Maybe they even developed in the middle. You have to re-diagnose kids every time you see them.
But if you don't even think about the alternatives, the differential diagnosis, and that just gets back to your point, that if you're not even considering that it could be mixed features, then that's even off the table. And that's the thing I think is a really important takeaway from today's presentation, is that you've got to think about the differential diagnosis. Even if the probabilities reduce specificity, it doesn't matter. You still need to think about it. And it's consequential for kids because you do have potentially this, well, you have to manage the boxed warning, nevertheless. You know, the prescription rates for antidepressants went down after that boxed warning came out. What do you think happened to suicide rates? Globally, they went up. And so, you know, we're in a very rock and a hard place situation with, particularly with kids, because we don't want to put them at risk. We don't want to make things worse, but we also don't want to miss treating them.